What we know as nepotism, favouring a relative for a job or a position of power, or really any advantage, because they are your relative, is surely absolutely core to how human societies work today, and probably always have. But nepotism and generational access aren't the carrot and stick of dynastic interests and actions alone. Normal people are not only affected by nepotism, but are just as prone to it as the ruling class. Let me tell you why. Ooh. In the United States, according to the General Social Survey from the University of Chicago in 2022, which looked at data from between 1994 and 2016, if you are a woman whose father is a doctor, you are 19 times more likely to become a doctor than a woman whose father is not a doctor. If he's a lawyer, you're 27 times more likely to become a lawyer than the average woman. There's a similar trend for sons. If your mother is a clinical laboratory technician, you're 38 times more likely to become one yourself. If your father is a drywall installer, you're 136 times more likely to become one. If your father is a textile machine operator, it jumps to 415 times more likely. However, the overall rate at which people take on the same career as their parents is significantly smaller. Men are 2 to 2.7 times as likely to have the same job as one of their parents, and women are 1.7 to 1.8 times as likely. The study also found that children are less likely to follow in the footsteps of their parents' careers if they are middle managers, clerical workers, or service workers. Ooh, I wonder why. Obviously, as the study surmises, a big factor involved is the connections that parents can offer their children. It is, after all, going to be easier to get your first shit-eating internship at HSBC if your dad is VP there, versus if you live in Oklahoma with Billy No-Mates. Equally, the reason the kids of lawyers are far more likely to become lawyers than a randomly chosen person, but far less likely to become lawyers than textile machinists' sons are to become textile machinists, is because they have much more social opportunity. If you want to become a doctor, you will have better social connections, almost certainly a better education, possibly access to your parents' social or professional network, and be much more likely to succeed in trying to become a doctor if your parents are lawyers, rather than if your parents work in a big factory on the sewing machines. So too, if you compare the lawyer drywaller stats, I think it's fair to say that these stats don't tell us, yeah, drywalling's basically sewn up, got to know someone to break into that, but rather the upper middle, or you might say executive classes, have much more elbow room to pick and choose. The Chicago study also discusses what it calls the breakfast table effect. Parents talking about their careers with their children, who pick up and learn it themselves. In interviews for the study, people who took the same career paths as their parents described it as speaking the same language.
I think it was on my 17th birthday. We were really talking about kind of like which schools I should apply to or whatever. And they started pitching their professions to me. You know, he wanted me to be an actor or a director, you know.
I went to school with a kid who became a washing machine repairman because his dad was a washing machine repairman and taught him how to repair washing machines while he was still at school. And when he left school, he got a job straight away for his dad as a washing machine repairman. Technically nepotism. But, I mean, it makes sense, doesn't it? What else was he going to do? No, well, I'll go to community college for a couple of years and learn how to be an air conditioning fitter. The important difference between nepotism in jobs and across society is their wider effect, the power they wield. To lock people out of their profession, to lock out or control regulators, to keep the money moving around the club of chums and not out of it. We'll get a little glimpse of the nepotism in politics later. An extremely coveted profession is to be anything in Hollywood, especially an actor, because, well, you can make a lot of money, you can be adored, you can be one of the beautiful people. There definitely are people in Hollywood, in all professions, who are self-made. And that idea is incredibly important to the industry, because it's that that keeps the labor class of US cinema, the overworked day actors, crew members, staff writers, churning in and out. But it's really very close to people who don't already have access, i.e. to people whose dad didn't direct Willow. A masterpiece, I will admit. Here is a fantastically patronizing post from that particular director's daughter, basically saying that if you can't break into mainstream roles, you need to multi-hyphen. That's how she succeeded, you see, from working hard. Well, she was in one of Dad's movies when she was 8. In fact, she was in her 20s before she was in a movie not directed by her dad. But you know, it was the multi-hyphen thing, that's what did it. But the incestuousness of it is probably better exemplified by this. Now let's do fun with transitions, like so it'll come up my hand when I do it. Okay, ready? Like this. That's how you know I've got production value. Are we rolling? Actor and model Maya Hawke is the daughter of Ethan Hawke and Uma Thurman. She began her career at the age of 18, becoming the face of British fashion brand All Saints, and starring in a video campaign for Calvin Klein, directed by Sofia Coppola. Her very first acting job in 2017, at the age of 19, was playing the main character, Jo March, in the Little Women miniseries on BBC. I saw it, it was rubbish. 2 years later, at 21 years old, she played a small but important role in Quentin Tarantino's Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Tarantino previously made 3 films starring Uma Thurman. You know, her mum, whom he once referred to as his muse, and presumably said some things about her feet.
Well, obviously, I have kind of known Quentin my whole life. You want to answer this one?
Hawke told The Hollywood Reporter that she did the audition for the film in her bedroom with her dad. As an aside, Hawke wasn't the only Nepo baby in Once Upon a Time. The film also featured the daughter of Bruce Willis, the daughter of Andy McDowell, and the daughter of Kevin Smith. That same year, in 2019, she began playing a main character, Robin Buckley, in Stranger Things, which her dad kindly helped her promote on his Instagram. It's not that him doing that is bad, probably most parents would do that, but the advantage is clear. Now, at the age of 25, Hawke has 28 acting credits, including in films starring each of her parents. She also started a music career, recording with Grammy Award winner Jesse Harris. Her dad, Ethan Hawke, directed one of her music videos. Ethan Hawke wasn't born to famous actor parents, but he did go to a boarding school, the Hun School of Princeton, that has a current tuition rate of $73,000 a year for high schoolers. After that, he studied at Carnegie Mellon University. I stress that these are real names. Current tuition, $62,000 per year, before dropping out when he was cast in Dead Poets Society. Uma Thurman, on the other hand, has a more solid upper-class pedigree. Her mother, Nina von Schlebrug, was a high-fashion model born in Mexico to a German nobleman, somehow, and Swedish model. Her father, Robert Thurman, is an author and professor at Columbia University. His parents were Elizabeth Dean Farrar, an actress, and Beverly Reed Thurman, Jr., a UN translator and editor for the Associated Press, and was briefly married to an heiress of the world's largest offshore drilling company, Schlumberger. Again, I stress that all these names are real. But this example doesn't even scratch the surface when it comes to Hollywood Nepo incestism. The Coppolas have forged themselves a dynasty. You've got Francis Ford, Sophia, Jason, not Luke Wilson Schwartzman, and indeed, Big Nicky Coppola, I mean, Nicky Cages. And like any dynasty, they marry into other dynasties. Nick Cage alone begged himself an Arquette and a Presley. His oldest son, Weston Cage, is a jobbing actor whose first appearance was in a Nicolas Cage film. You might wonder, well, how do we know talent doesn't run in the family? Sure, genetics don't work that way, but surely talent can rub off on people. Well, the answer is simple. Two words, in fact. Sophia Coppola.
There's a mob of hunters.
But of course, that's a joke. Sophia Coppola is very talented, how very dare I? You can argue about the merits of talent and how important to succeeding as a famo, having a famous daddy is or not, forever. I'm not sure how influential Hollywood really is, and the Coppolas are of course only a sliver of that, but they surely can influence society just a little bit, and a hell of a lot more than we shit-eaters. But while these people might enjoy a concentration of power, it's nowhere near as important as the nepotism in politics. Neither G.W. Bush nor Hillary Clinton's would have ever been able to run for president if they did not have a close relative who was once the president. Their relationships gave them political capital you just can't buy. By the estimation of economist Seth Stevens Davidovits, in 2015, if your parent was a senator, you were 8,500 times more likely to become a senator than the average person. And you thought drywalling was nepotistic. But political power and influence are not confined to elected officials, and there's significant crossover between politicians and other elite professions. Stevens Davidovits also estimates that an American male is 4,582 times more likely to become an army general if his father was one, 1,895 times more likely to become a famous CEO, 1,639 times more likely to win a Pulitzer Prize if his father had won one, 1,497 times more likely to win a Grammy, and 1,361 times more likely to win an Academy Award. Now, I stress that I am not making the case that the captains of industry, the politicians, the decision makers, are all in a big conspiracy together. Not at all. They're all at least as much rivals as they are colleagues. But I think it's fair to say that these statistics make it pretty clear. Sure, to be an army general or CEO, you need acumen, probably even talent, but nothing compares to that family connection. And nepotism like this undermines the idea that we live in a real democracy, not just kind of a democracy. Certainly not a meritocracy. It's worth saying too, that nepotism is very hard to track over time, especially as the World Economic Forum stopped trying to track it recently. But it's not exactly new. It's hard to tell how much spread there is across the world. All we've got to go on there is this WEF chart from 15 years ago. But that measures perception of nepotism's impact on business. There does seem to be correlation between corruption and nepotism. And the stats I've referred to in this video exclusively deal with the USA. What is clear though, and I would be astounded if the USA is the anomaly here, is that nepotism exists virtually on all levels of class. It's just not as noticeable and surely less socially relevant the further down the totem you get. According to a YouGov poll this year, 2023 if you're watching it in the future, 42% of Americans say they have used their personal contacts to connect a relative or friend with a job opportunity. And slightly fewer, 35%, have themselves benefited from a job connection made by a relative or friend. I think a good example of normal person level nepotism with wide-ranging, socially corrosive effects is this recent story of a Staten Island traffic cop reprimanded for giving traffic tickets to friends and relatives of other cops in violation of traffic laws. Essentially, it is not disputed that police in New York and elsewhere give out unofficial courtesy cards, and I can't really imagine you can dispute that they are used to get out of infractions. Why else would they possibly exist? Bianchi, the cop in question, alleges that he was retaliated against for doing his job, for giving people traffic tickets, even if they knew a cop. Essentially, his union refused to protect him from retaliation because, well, this was a benefit all cops could enjoy, and that's obviously more important than maintaining public trust, or not being corrupt, or, you know, doing your duty. Now, this might sound trivial, and in the grand scheme of things, it surely is. But these things are deeply important to the social outlook of a community, and of a nation. Why don't some people trust the cops? Why don't some people trust the cops? More consequential, but again, not the realm of kingmakers and industry titans, is the case of Alex Murdaugh. The Murdaugh family came to national attention recently because, as well as being tied to a couple of other weird deaths, one of the younger members almost certainly got a girl killed in a river, was all set to evade justice with the help of his well-connected father, and was then murdered alongside his mother by his father. There are at least a couple of good documentaries out there, if you fancy that. The Murdaugh family occupied the 14th district position of circuit solicitor, essentially district attorney, for 5 counties in South Carolina, and they occupied that position for nearly 86 years. After that, Randolph Murdaugh III and Alex Murdaugh maintained influence over the solicitor's office by volunteering there and running their own family firm simultaneously, to the point that the 5 counties in the 14th Circuit that they ruled over became known as Murdaugh County, to the point where the American Tort Foundation Forum called the 14th Circuit a judicial hellhole for defendants back in 2004. The family used their connections to evade legal consequences numerous times. They embezzled from the county, their own law firm, their own clients, and they did so with the confidence of someone who knows they are untouchable. They almost certainly prevented at least one death, possibly 3, from being properly investigated in order to save their own truculent existences as kings of some swamp. This all came to national attention with the double homicide. If Alex Murdaugh hadn't killed his wife and kid, he'd still be doing this. And so, a thought occurs. A particularly sad thought. But that's why you're here, right? I sure hope so. Personally, I used to be under the impression that the human realm is fundamentally broken. Our ruling and influential positions are occupied by people who never earned it, and if they did, they earned it from being slippery and duplicitous. People who are primarily interested in themselves, and who have little problem appearing corrupt and nepotistic because, what are you going to do, peons? The possibility of voting them out, or reforming, seems ever out of reach. The general population is too disillusioned and too disempowered to care very much or act in any way beyond token protest. But what if it isn't broken at all? What if this is the natural state of things? I mean, you really can look at world history as a slap fight between dynasties in various leagues of clout, all crawling and writhing all for a little bit more, but not crawling and writhing on the floor, but the rest of us. Equally too, people have acknowledged and written about nepotism and corruption for a long, long time. Ancient Greece and beyond. What if, whether it is optimal or not, this is inescapable human behavior? I've referred to US examples almost exclusively here, but it's not the most nepotistic or corrupt country. Certainly not. But the US's branding is all about meritocracy, pulling your bootstraps up and achieving, not in your class, but on a level playing field. Yes, the reality makes that seem hypocritical in the same way as a billionaire talking about fighting climate change before getting back on their private jet to fly to Caligula's island. But there is hope. This conversation is not just consigned to the darkest, despair-filled corners of YouTube. Hello. There are people talking about this. Not just me, real people. There are legal academics and social and political scholars whose whole professional life is about this. Really, nepotism, and more specifically socially corrosive nepotism, is a symptom of social stratification. And there are lots of people talking about that now, especially since COVID. I.e., I lost my minimum wage job, but my multi-state employer made money with PPP that was meant to be for them to keep employing me. I was a waiter and had to risk my health because apparently I'm an essential worker. My pay hasn't gone up in 20 years, but my boss's pay and the shareholders' dividends, they've sure gone up. Did eggs always cost this much? Is that the price of my water bill? When are they going to start charging me for the oxygen I breathe? Oh, check it out, another grassroots candidate funded by a billionaire. So I think normal people, with enormous thanks to the internet in general, are starting to see these problems and how it affects them and keeps them in their place. I really do think there can be changes, but as ever, we're talking decades. But there is hope. Are you a young person thinking of getting into law or something like that? Remember all of this and do your own reading and you'll find plenty more. And you know, maybe in 20 years you'll have an opportunity to vanquish some of the corruption that seems so very endemic. Perhaps. Anyway, thanks for watching. I'll call my dad now and get one of his minions to publish this because he is the head of YouTube. I have a new show every Sunday with my long-suffering wife where we talk about TV, national tragedies, Frasier, that sort of thing. Sort of in a podcasty format, but you can actually watch it and see my happy face smiling and my wife's happy face. Smiling. Yeah, smile. That wasn't a smile. Right, that's it. That is it. Support me on Patreon if you're fancy. I'm not flush with cash, that's why I ask. If I was, I'd be like, I'm doing a reverse Patreon. Sign up if you want $5. But you better give me some, you better send me a video. But I'll give you $5. You know, you take some, you leave some. All right, see you then. That made perfect sense, everything I just said. So I'll go with that. This is the take we're using.